All right, ladies, everyone sit up on the bike. You're going to roll your shoulders back. Everyone, deep breath in through your nose. Some nice shoulder rolls. Thank you for joining us online or in person here. I just want to pray a blessing over everyone here today. We'll get started in just a minute with the playlist. My name is Lisa. This is Miranda with Faith Fitness. And we are here to just encourage you in the Word of God. We thank you that we get to move our bodies as an act of worship today. This is no striving. We get to sit in this place and thank the Lord for how He made us today. And that truly is what we're about here. 1 Timothy 4:8 says, "For physical training is of some value, but training for godliness, what God says about you, what God says about the matter, has value for all things, holding promise for this life and the life to come." So we claim that right here in this time. So Heavenly Father, we thank you for your beautiful Son, Jesus. We thank you that we get to come, like I said, and move our bodies as an act of worship to you, Lord. We thank you that it's a get to. It's a place where we can find freedom and joy, Lord, because Jesus sees us already. He sees us. God sees us through the blood of his Son. Jesus was the perfect sacrifice. The Old Testament talks about day after day, the priest had to perform the religious duties of offering the animal sacrifices, Lord, but you had a better plan. You had a better plan that you yourself came down to be the perfect sacrifice that you offered of yourself once and for all those who believe in the name of Jesus. So we worship you here in this place and we lift up your name high. I pray a blessing over the ladies listening and the ladies online. Let your word go out and accomplish the purposes for which you sent it, Lord. Amen. This first song, we're warming up. We are warming up here. So this is about your worship time. We'll give some invitations to push if you want to. You want to stay seated. If you want to get off the bike and raise your hands high, we encourage that too. Let it all go. What else you have to do today? Any agenda you have? You've got 40 minutes here in this place to invite Jesus to come just speak to your heart. You can sit up straight, roll your shoulders back, roll your neck. You kind of grip a lot while we're doing this, so warm it up. Okay.
satisfied. Here with you, here with you. Chains will hit the floor. Broken lives restored. We couldn't ask for more. Here with you, here with you.
Hands on me. I just feel the word of the Lord coming over us this morning. Forget the former things and do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. The wild animals honor me and the jackals and the owls because I provide water in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland to give drink to my people, my chosen, the people I formed for myself, that they may proclaim my praise. Lord, we thank you for the new thing that you are doing. God, I thank you, and I give you praise even for this last year, year and a half, where you have shaken the whole world. You have shaken and tore down rubble of old ways, Lord. And everywhere we look, even though we don't perceive it, you are doing a new thing. So we worship you, Lord. I worship you for the new thing that you're doing in the ladies right here in this room and those that are watching online. Lord God, help us to be willing to pivot and move to the new thing that you are doing. The Pharisees and those people of the law who knew the word better than I probably ever will of the Old Testament, they missed you. They missed you. And yet, you said they preached life that is only found in me, and they missed it because they wanted you to do their kingdom and their kingdom come. That's why the first prayer you said, when you told your disciples how to pray, you said, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, and your will be done. Lord, align our eyes to your kingdom and help us not miss the new thing that you were doing. Thank you, Jesus. You want to stand for this song? Go ahead, take a stand. You want a seat? Just tap that resistance a touch. What do you want to do for this song? Expected him to come in another way. Jesus was putting this on my heart from Acts 1. In my former book, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. So John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, this is the part here, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? The disciples also asked that, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Jesus, forgive us for when we expect you to show up in a certain way. Forgive me when I've expected you to answer a prayer in a certain way. He turned to his disciples and he said, or the disciples said, Lord, are you now going to restore the kingdom? I love in the Gospels, he says, the kingdom of God is within your midst. Jesus is the kingdom of God has come near. When he goes out in his ministry, he says, repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. You can turn heavy if you want. What do you want for this song? Even as we forget that, I was thinking about right after that, after he said, you're going to be my disciples. He said, you're going to have power when the Holy Spirit comes. That's why he told his disciples in John, no, it's going to be better for you that I go. I think about, maybe we don't make this connection, but Peter was powerless. He denied you Christ 3 times, and he saw him in the flesh and blood. He was in the inner circle of Jesus, and yet he still failed. Jesus is like, even my physical presence, he's like, I gotta go, because I'm gonna send my spirit. Do you believe that over your life today? It's his spirit. And I'm thinking about this too. It says, after he said this, which the part we can read in Acts 1, after he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up in the sky as he was going, when suddenly 2 men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. Maybe we're standing and we're still waiting, but maybe the Lord wants us to know by his power and to be ready for that new thing. Maybe you're supposed to testify to someone at the grocery store. Maybe you're supposed to ask somebody that they need prayer. The kingdom of God is working, it's moving, and it's in our midst. He invites us to be a part of it. He's giving up there his spirit, the Holy Spirit. He's doing a new thing. That's why he came. It was a new and living covenant. The law was unable to be accomplished by any human being.
Yeah.
But Jesus fulfilled the whole law so that we might live by the law of the Spirit. Romans 8. Read Romans 8 today. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promises, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Jesus, thank you. you had a better plan. I think about Thomas often, who doubted. He said, but how will we know the way? This is what Jesus' last days before he goes. He knows his time is coming to go back to the Father. That his time of suffering, he's going to walk to the cross. Thomas says, when the disciples says, the Lord, how will we know the way? I am the way, the truth, and the life. The Lord put that on my heart this morning in John 14, which she just said a little bit ago. But you know him, for he is in you. I must go to prepare a place for you. Give it a push right here. Turn it. Give it a little tap. If you love me, you would be glad that I'm going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. What promise has he given you? I think it's important for the credibility and the magnitude of our God that he would use faulty men.
Yes.
Kind of seems like a bad plan. I tell the Lord that myself. I'm like, are you sure? Because I could be really wicked. I mean, are you sure I'm the best use? Yeah, because 2 Corinthians 12, his grace is sufficient. His power is made perfect in our weakness. And like I mentioned about Peter, he denied Christ. Not only did he deny him, but he called curses on himself. There is a group in the Christian community that say, oh, if you say that, you're agreeing with the devil, and now that's going to happen, and that karma. He called curses on himself. He knows what it was like to be sifted, to fail. One of the accounts, I believe it was in Luke, it says, and the third time when he denied Christ, because he was in the outer courtyard and Jesus was in the inner courtyard, it said Jesus looked at him. Can you imagine the failure, the tears, the mourning? That's why when we look at 1st and 2nd Peter, he's so credible. So many times he's like, be alert. Be alert. Be sober-minded. And I'm thinking about Peter's words in 1 Peter 4:1. He says, therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because whoever suffers in the body is done with sin. As a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. And I think even that with the Pharisees and them missing the kingdom of God, I was just reflecting that I would say, I feel like half of my suffering, maybe three-fourths, maybe all of it, in suffering that I've had in my life, God has been whittling away at my kingdom come.
Yeah.
And calling me to lose it all, to follow him. And it's like the very thing that we're trying to build and claw and grasp at and control, it just crumbles. Jesus is like, give it to me. My marriage was saved. My children have been saved. I've seen Lisa's so much testimony in her family and anyone else that I come across that's willing to die and lose it all for the kingdom of God. To live. But maybe some of that suffering and some of those hardships are actually the Lord calling you so lovingly and so faithfully to lay aside your kingdom so you don't miss His kingdom. He would rather us suffer a little and cry and throw our fists to rescue us from eternal separation. So it's worth it. He's not unloving. It's actually the opposite. It's actually His love. I couldn't tell you guys how many fists I have thrown to God. I've been a little brat. I tell people, well, half my testimony is I fought God and God won. It's not like real lovely and pretty. It's not a pretty story. It's not like total surrender. That sounds great. Let's kill Miranda today. No. Fighting and clawing, and yet every time I release and I yoke up to His kingdom, He takes care of my kids. He takes care of my marriage. He even gives me more.
Thank you.
Lord, set our eyes on Your kingdom. Help us not miss Your kingdom. Your love is so great. You are willing to let things die in our lives so that we may truly take hold of that which is life. We thank You, Lord. Matthew 6 says, do not worry about what you will eat, what you will wear, about your body. Didn't I clothe you? Didn't I feed you when you were hungry? Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first the kingdom of God and all His righteousness, and all will be given to you. I keep feeling when I go back to say, like, look different. The disciples said, now are you going to restore the kingdom? And he responds with, do not worry about the dates or the times, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will witness and testify in Jerusalem and Samaria and to the end of the earth. I want to testify today that the Lord did give me a hard word, because in my flesh, why does He have the right to quit and I got to keep working? I got to keep doing this. I got to keep doing that. You know what the hard word the Lord gave me after I cried and I grumbled for a week about this? The weeping and gnashing of teeth. Lisa, it doesn't look like Your kingdom, what I'm doing now. Look how you think it should be perceived. But it's for my kingdom. The weeping and gnashing of teeth refers to when Jesus comes back. And He does judge the earth. He does judge the earth. Every knee, in Philippians 2 says, every knee will bow and every tongue confess the name of Jesus. When He said that to me, I was like, who am I? You're working a greater work. You're working a greater work of salvation. And I repented. Can I tell you now, I'm seeing salvation rise up in my home. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, don't you worry about the days or the times. But when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you must be my witness. Don't worry about that. I'm going to take care of that. But I'm asking you to seek first the kingdom of God and my righteousness, and all else will be given to you. Is He answering in a different way to something to you today? That is what faith is. Confidence in what we hope for, and assurance of what we don't get to see. Because we know Him who came. Him who came for us. Rush. I see a city.
tested. What love is. He's afraid to see, but Jesus says when he speaks, it's only lies. That's his native tongue. It's the only one he knows. And I have seen in our culture, he has taken the character of God and put it on himself and twisted it in a perverse way and then taken his evil in people's minds and tried to twist it to that's what God is. And one of the things that Satan did to try to get Peter's eyes off of the kingdom of God was when Jesus in Matthew 16, again, here we have Peter. Think about these things that I'm saying today, and then when you go read 1st and 2nd Peter, it gives credibility, mostly to God more than Peter, but to the transformation. Here he was with Jesus. The Lord said to me one day, you think it's hard? You think it's hard for you? These guys couldn't do it. They couldn't do it when they walked with me and saw me in the flesh. But Thomas, who said, I will only believe if I see it. And the Lord says, blessed are those who come after you, who believe and do not see. So, I'm going to get back to this in Matthew 16. Jesus says, I'm going to die. I'm going to go, but I have to die. I have to die. It's the only way. And Peter, he comes with a pity that comes from hell. And he says, never, Lord, this shall never happen to you. And Jesus turned to Peter and he said to him, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, and you do not have the mind that concerns of God, but merely human concerns. And then he said to his disciples, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me will find it. The Holy Spirit is convicting me right now. Whew. Am I willing to lose every part of my life for the kingdom of God? Or am I going to claw and I'm going to try to save it? See, that wasn't pretty. That doesn't look like a successful plan. To go die? You look like that looks bad. That looks like they mocked him on the cross. That doesn't look pretty or polished. That looks like an unsuccessful campaign in the eyes of the world. But what if God is calling us to that same? It might look weird in the world. It might look unsuccessful. But to God and his kingdom, it's everything. And see, I love that even though Jesus spoke such a direct and harsh word, it gives me hope because right before that passage, you could go read Matthew 16 today. He tells Peter, you're the rock. I'm going to build the church on you. And the gates of hell will not prevail. Might look like they're prevailing sometimes, but they will not prevail. I'm giving you keys and you bind and you loop and whatever you do here on earth, so it is in heaven. So what a hope for us. That's why sometimes Jesus has to say to me, get behind me, Satan, Miranda. Your mind is lined up with human desires, not mine. And that, my friends, is love. Love speaks truth. There's never a truth that Jesus has said to me that hasn't made me run away. The enemy wants to shame me when that is different. Shame is like you are bad. Shame is hopelessness. It's condemnation. It's attack without hope. 2 Corinthians 7:10 says, for godly sorrow leads to repentance that leads to life. But worldly sorrow leads to death and regret without life. So I will tell you if you want to know the difference. Because when the Lord said it to you, when the Lord said it to me, he course corrected me in my prayers.
Yeah.
That's why I prayed for my son. Oh Lord, please don't make him suffer. The Lord said, no, Miranda. You do not know what your boy needs to come to me. And he got saved that year. Salvation that I know is true. And I trust God with no matter where he's at or what age he is. And if I would have gotten away and I would have tried to save him from suffering, he would not. The Lord said, you thing. You don't know. Get behind me, Satan. Your mind is on the things of man. But you guys are such a quick coming back. I'm like, okay, yes, Christ. There's no condemnation. But Peter, he kept loving Peter. Even restored Peter. He didn't have to restore him. At the end of John, he restores Peter after he had denied him. His love isn't extinguished by our sin. That's what kept him on the cross to pay the full price for. But his love also does not leave you alone in your sin. It chases after you so that you will be used as an instrument of righteousness, that I will be used as an instrument of righteousness. Thank you, Jesus, for your faithfulness. Suffering. You can slow down and read this. In Acts 16, Paul and Silas are in prison. They had been, starting in 23, they had been severely flogged. They were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. So they were out proclaiming the name of the Lord. The gospel, the true gospel. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once all the prison doors flew open and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself, we are all here." The jailer called for lights, rushed in, and fell trembling before Paul and Silas. He brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They replied, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household." Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others in his house. At that hour of the night, the jailer took them and washed their wounds, and then immediately he and his household were baptized. The jailer brought them into his house and set a meal before them. He was filled with joy because he had come to believe in God. He and his whole household. When it was daylight, the magistrates sent their officers to the jailer with the order, "Release those men." The jailer told Paul, "The magistrates have ordered that you and Silas be released. Now you can leave, go in peace." But Paul said to the officers, "They beat us. They beat us publicly without a trial, even though we were Roman citizens and threw us into prison. And now do they want to get rid of us quietly? No, let them come out themselves and escort us out." Lord, thank you that sometimes you have us walk through things that look different. Help our perspective shift to the God, I know you are working. I know you are doing something new, Father.
No, wait, they said to the jailer. Don't harm yourself, because we're still here. Our chains have been busted open. Jesus came, and we could have ran out of here. We were in prison. But instead, let me speak the word of the Lord to you. The jailer said, what must I do to be saved? And at that moment, him and his whole household came to believe in the name. Thank you that it looks different, Lord. Thank you, Jeremiah 17, he kept bringing me to as well. Cursed are those who trust in man, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord. We thank you for meeting us here today, Jesus. We thank you for the entire Word of God. It is all sound doctrine. Thank you that all of the Word is helpful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God might be thoroughly equipped for every good work. I pray a blessing over your listening today, God, that you water that soil. Thank you that your word says, I may plant it, or Apollos might do this, but it is the Lord who makes it grow. So we claim that in this place and over the online of anyone listening, Lord God, today, tomorrow, 5 years from now. We thank you for the love of Jesus. Amen. Thanks for joining us online. And we'll be stretching here. Make sure you stretch as well.